Welcome, welcome. I'm so glad you joined us today. My name is Amelia Larson, and I serve as the Executive Vice President of Innovations and Academic Partnerships at American Reading Company. And today I'm joined by Matt Weir, my co-host, and he serves as the Vice President of Teaching and Learning. Thank you for joining us. We will be recording today's session. You will receive an email link to the recording along with information regarding our upcoming webinars. Please feel free to submit your comments and questions in the chat box. We have two very important people, Heather Lemke and David Burns, who will be monitoring the chat, answering questions, and elevating your points. We also are going to try to leave some time at the end of our session for additional Q&A. Don't forget, if you are using social media today, remember to use the hashtag ArcLearns. The topic today is close to my heart: reading and writing integration. We all know that good readers and writers are not born, they are taught. So what can we do to ensure that children, all children, access the literacy instruction needed to fully develop these very complex but interdependent skills? Implementing a high-quality, knowledge-building curricula can improve student outcomes. We know that teaching reading improves writing. Teaching writing improves reading. And writing about content improves learning. But what does such a framework look like? What are the key elements that will help all learners flourish and grow from beginning readers and writers into proficient ones? Well, have no fear. It is my honor to welcome back our friend and Academic Advisory Board member, Jeff Wilhelm. Dr. Wilhelm has been a classroom teacher and is a distinguished professor of English education at Boise State University. He has authored and co-authored over 40 texts about literacy, teaching, and learning. He's one of the most gracious human beings I know, and it's very committed to increasing the expertise of all he comes in contact with. So you are in for a treat. Dr. Wilhelm, it's all yours.
Thank you so much, Amelia. I appreciate that. And welcome to everybody who's here today, and thank you for joining us. So we're going to be doing a deep dive today into integrating reading and writing, and also integrating content and strategy learning. What do teachers and learners need to know and be able to do to make this happen? So our goals and working assumptions for this session is that our job as teachers is to make public those secret things that expert readers and writers know, think, and do in order to engage and make meaning, and then apprentice learners into engaging with, knowing, thinking, and doing those expert things. This requires what's called pedagogical content knowledge, which simply means knowing how to teach learners how to engage, think, know, and do like experts. A challenge that we're going to take up here is placed on us by the latest NAEPS and PISA results, which reveal that students need a lot of help with identifying topics, identifying key details, identifying patterns and gaps in key details, inferring to fill the gaps and interpret connections among key details, genre knowledge, and reading for main idea or theme, which is a topic comment. You're going to see how all of these are connected, and if we don't address a single one of those, then all the others are going to suffer. A central takeaway of our work today will be the mind wants to situate and integrate. It wants to put things together that go together in meaningful contexts of use. I often show my students this picture over here on your right, and I ask them, "What do you see?" And they often really struggle. And then I'll say, "Oh, my bad. I gave it to you upside down." And then they start to see it. If they have any trouble, I go, "Well, you know, this picture's from the Middle Ages." I might even say, "Look at that upper left-hand corner." You know, and very quickly they can see that it's a knight on horseback. Now, this foregrounds a couple of things. You have to have a purpose and be correctly oriented to a text to begin to make meaning. And if you have any background knowledge of all, it's really going to aid your comprehension. Again, the central takeaway, the mind wants to situate and integrate, to put things together that go together in a meaningful context of use. And that requires filling in a lot of gaps, a lot of blanks. And this is much harder to do if instruction takes things apart. So we must learn how to situate and integrate our instructional support for reading, writing, learning content, and learning different strategic processes. What I want to do with you very quickly is take you through four activities from some of the foundational research on comprehension. So this comes from the Bransford and Johnson studies on schema theory back in the 60s. A newspaper is better than a magazine. A seashore is a better place than the street. At first, it is better to run than to walk. You may have to try several times. It takes some skill, but it's easy to learn. Even young children can enjoy it. Once successful, complications are minimal. Birds seldom get in the way. Rain, however, soaks in very fast. Too many people can cause problems. It can be very peaceful. A rock will serve as an anchor. If things break loose, however, you will not get a second chance. Now, quite often when I show this to teachers or my students, they go, "We have no idea what it's about." And I'll say, "Do you have any trouble with the vocabulary? Are there any words that don't make sense?" Because we often conflate comprehension with vocabulary or decoding, which is a very minor part of overall comprehension. If I say to them, "Oh, this is about an activity with a toy you might make and use outside," then they start to activate background that can help them. If I tell them this is about flying a kite, instantly everything clicks into place and now everything makes sense. Now, if you've never seen this before and you were struggling to figure out what it meant, that's what a textbook looks like to a kid who doesn't know anything about the topic that's being explored. They may know all the words, they may know all the vocabulary, they may have what's called surface level comprehension, but they don't have this deep situated comprehension. Here's another famous one. I'm gonna ask you to read this as if you're a real estate agent. What do you need to remember? What would you need to tell somebody else and why? The house is set back from the road amid 3 acres of beautiful hardwoods. The nearest neighbors are over a quarter mile away. On the other side of the street, there's a small airport. You are 5 miles from a small town with excellent schools. A door on the side of the two-car garage is always open and provides easy access into the house. There are 4 other ways to enter and leave the house, including an old fruit cellar tunnel that leads out into the woods. The kitchen has been redone recently and has brand new Jenner appliances. This connects to the living room with a large bay window overlooking the front lawn. An original Hogarth print hangs on the wall and an antique oriental vase stands in the corner. An open staircase leads upstairs to 4 bedrooms. There are 2 baths, one of which is connected to the master bedroom. There is an open jewelry case, 4 passports and 3 cell phones and a bundle of cash on the bureau and a Moroccan rug on the floor. One of the bedrooms is currently being used as a study and contains a high-end computer and 2 laptops. There is a full attic where an observatory has been set up. A computerized telescope is set up near a dormer window and is trained on the airport. Now, if you're a realtor, there are certain things you're going to remember and you're going to have certain reasons for remembering that. In the study, they then asked people to read it as a robber. They remembered entirely different things. What was interesting too, was they remembered something similar, it was for a totally different reason because they had a different purpose. I've rewritten this and I use it with my kids and often ask them, "You're a CIA agent." They remember completely different things. Sometimes some of them are similar to the robber, but their reasons for remembering it, their overall situation or story world is totally different. This study showed that it's your purpose that drives your engagement. In fact, kids who play the role of robbers or CIA agents are way more engaged than those playing real estate agents. So your purpose, the edgier the purpose, the more your motivation and engagement. But your purpose always drives your engagement, what you attend to, what you notice, what you remember, and your overall conception of the text. Here's a text from another one of the foundational studies. You can see most of the information's left out. If you're my age, you pretty quickly go, oh, I recognize this. It's a Dear John letter. I used to call them Dear Jeff letters, but we won't get into that right now. And as soon as you recognize it as a Dear John letter, as soon as you recognize the genre, then you'll be able to fill in all the missing pieces. Dear John, I can't marry you anymore. Or excuse me, I can't marry you. I don't love you anymore. I love your brother or your best friend or your bookmaker. At that point, you don't care. Sincerely, Jane. By the way, they're always signed sincerely. I can attest to this personally, as if you need her sincerity right now. The point that this study made was that we always read a text as something. And when you know what that something is, it helps you do all the other things that the NAEPs and PISA show kids have trouble with. It helps you understand the content, the topic, the key details, the patterning of the key details. There are elaborations on this genre, but this is the basic structure. When you know the basic structure, you can fill in all kinds of missing information, make all kinds of inferences, and it helps you to do all the other things that expert readers do. Now, the latest NAEPs and PISA results tell us really compellingly that even high school seniors struggle with inferencing. Over the last several NAEPs, for instance, it's been much fewer than 8% of graduating high school seniors who can see what are called complex implied relationships in an extended text and connect the dots to figure out what those connections mean. Here's just a short example from one of those foundational studies. A man came inside and sat down in the very last booth. He ordered and ate bacon, eggs, and wheat toast. 1 hour later, he finished his third cup of decaffeinated coffee. He left but forgot his umbrella in the morning copies of the Wall Street Journal. He left a big tip, smiled at the waitress, and said goodbye to her. Now, if you can only read literally, where was he and what did he order? Now, you are probably quickly saying he was in a cafe or he was in a restaurant and he ordered and ate bacon, eggs, wheat toast, and decaffeinated coffee. However, you inferred that because it never says where he is. You had to use your life knowledge, your background, and bring it to bear on the text to figure that out. That's why approaches that focus solely on the text and not on what readers need to bring to the text are insufficient. If you said he ordered decaffeinated coffee, it doesn't say that here. You added that because you know you're highly unlikely to get three cups of something you didn't order. That's part of your restaurant schema. Now, luckily, these are called simple implied relationships, and high school seniors can do this. However, now we get to complex implied. Why did he come here? You would have to look at a lot of details in the text, add your life knowledge, and figure something out that makes sense according to the text and your life knowledge. Like maybe he's retired and lonely. Maybe he's sweet on the waitress. Maybe this is his morning routine. He's certainly not a teacher because he's hanging out all day in the cafe. What was the weather like when he came and departed? It doesn't say. But if you're like me and you've left umbrellas all over the world, you know that you take an umbrella when it's raining or threatening to rain, and you forget it if it's not raining when you leave. So you would know it was raining when he came and it wasn't raining when he left. Now, that's in the text. You have to attend to those textual details, but you also have to bring your life knowledge to bear. What kind of person might he be? This requires connecting a lot of dots inside the text, but also from your own life to the text. You know, you'd have to know that he's probably retired or his free time, or maybe he's single, or, you know, and a lot of these things are tentative kinds of guesses that you would look to an extended text to either confirm or disconfirm. So these kind of inferences are often highly tentative. Now, here's the takeaway from those four quick examples. Reading and all knowledge production is more complicated than we think, and it requires really robust instruction. So before reading, composing, or any kind of learning, we must activate background knowledge of content and procedure, build background knowledge, both conceptual and procedural, that might be necessary to understanding the text, have a clear and engaging purpose and payoff, because that'll drive our engagement, what we notice, how we interpret. And we have to understand the genre conventions of the text to be read or composed. These things work together to help us create meaning. And if students read, compose, and learn, they must be able to comprehend the facts, but also infer connections across facts, which may extend across a very extended text, connect the dots, fill in the gaps, figure forth, predict, et cetera, and critique and apply what they are learning. All of this is in service of bringing things together. Seminal research by Walter Kinch, George Hillocks, and many other people have shown the most effective instruction creates a situated, integrated whole, and it promotes students doing that work. What is known as a situation model, or a complete story world consistent with all the textual details and what you know from your life, or a conceptual mental model of the central topic that mirrors understanding of how the text was constructed to communicate that meaning and effect. Kinch's research led to these three levels of comprehension that you have to comprehend the factual level of the text, but this leads to the inferential interpretive level and to the critical applicative levels. He argued that texts are represented in our minds at three levels: the surface base, or decoding of individual words and phrases; the text base, which is the comprehension of propositions at the local level of the text; and the situation model, which is the creation of a coherent mental model or story world. And he applied what he called a standard of coherence, which means that good reading, good comprehension requires consistency between what the learner brings to the text and the mental model that's created for moving forward. Sometimes this requires students to change their schema to accommodate their schema to the new learning, or sometimes they can assimilate what they've learned into their existing schema in a way that makes it richer. Again, the brain wants to integrate parts into wholes. Now, the problem is separation of content and process, reading and composing. The solution is all of these elements are most usefully taught together through guided inquiry and cognitive apprenticeship approaches. This is where students are delving into a problem that's very interesting to them. They're reading a wide variety of text, and they're looking across the text to build knowledge. How can we improve learner standard of coherence? Through regular access to rich, complex grade level text, by asking questions and providing tasks that work towards coherent mental models of comprehension, not discrete standards or strategies. For example, question answer relationship questions. To placehold and explain your thinking, ask that kids do that always. For example, through think alouds, process analyses, reflections, through procedural feedback based on these explanations. Kids really understand something when they can procedurally feedback to an author, to themselves, to a peer. And they need texts that are worth all of this effort, that engage us all in inquiry to get real personal and social work done. So what should we do? There's two essential ingredients for expertise in any arena. Anders Ericsson's the world's expert on expertise. I wish I had that title. And his lifetime of work could be boiled down to these two things. To be an expert in any domain, you need a mental model. This is true of us as teachers. It's true of students when they're learning anything. You need a highly conscious and articulated representation of a task and how to complete it. Ericsson goes so far to say it should be a map, and it's probably visual, that shows you what to do. It's like a flow chart, how to solve problems. And you need deliberate practice with that mental model, by which he meant mindful focus practice aligned with the correspondence concept. The correspondence concept's a very elegant idea from cognitive science that simply means when we teach something, it better correspond to real world expertise. It better correspond to what real readers and real writers do. Here's the key insight. If you lack a mental model for a task, you can't get better at that task. George Hillocks did this research in early career teachers, and he found that typically they're unconsciously incompetent. They begin their career, they think this isn't as hard as I thought. This is an instantiation of the Dunning-Kruger effect. You get going with something, you think, yeah, it's not that bad. And then if you're reflective at all, pretty quickly you become consciously incompetent. You go, whoa, this is harder than I thought. This isn't working. Or you become unconsciously competent. You go, whoa, that was a great lesson. But if somebody asks you, what did you do to make that happen? Or how could you build on it? You don't know. You got no idea how you did it. Now, the goal of all teaching is conscious competence. It's the goal we have as teachers. We want to know how something works, how kids build knowledge, how they read a particular genre. Because that doesn't mean everything runs like a Cuisinart every time. We know that never happens. But what it means is when something goes well, you go, oh, I got a pretty good idea how I made that happen and how I can build on it. if something goes awry, as it often does, you go, I got a pretty good idea what I can do about that, how I can fix that tomorrow. Same thing for our students. We want them to be consciously competent at writing arguments, at reading historical fiction or fables. And they have to have a very consciously held mental model to have that kind of conscious competence. Now, here's our essential question about conscious competence with genre. What do learners need to know in order to read and write examples of a specific kind of genre? For example, narrative in general, or a specific kind of narrative like a historical fiction. And it's a bit more complicated than you think. It requires a mental model, and it requires integrated content and strategy use. Our threshold knowledge goals for the remainder of our session will be to understand genre and how it's a fairly narrow groove, and it must provide a specific mental map for readers and writers to follow. Genre is an integration of specific purposes, a specific form, so must make shaping moves, specific kinds of content, and specific social actions and takeaways. So if we understand genre, we're going to be able to address all those challenges the NAEPs and PISA show that even our graduating seniors have. And we're going to have to teach all these things together. And genre is a great way to make that happen. Here's a sub question. What do learners need to understand in order to read and write anything? In fact, understand anything. Now, in cognitive science, the answer would be five kinds of knowledge, which I want to apply to genre. And this comes from cognitive science research, the Fred Newman studies, George Hillock's research in literacy, and many others. So the five kinds of knowledge are knowledge of purpose, procedural knowledge of substance, which I call knowledge of how to get the stuff, procedural knowledge of form, I'd call that knowledge of how to form the stuff into a conventional genre, the naming of the form, and the naming of the stuff, declarative knowledge of form and substance. Now, all of these are necessary to deep understanding. It's true when you're reading, you know how to get the stuff from your own life knowledge, from your own experience, from your own knowledge of how texts work to get the stuff of the text. That's that local level comprehension, that surface comprehension, and the text comprehension. Then you need to know how to form the stuff into a story world that matches the genre of the text, or a mental model that maps, that mirrors the concepts that are being studied. And then you can name the form and name the stuff. This mirrors five kinds of composing. So getting your first ideas down about the purpose, what you already know, what you want to know, developing and placeholding new kinds of knowledge, informal writing where you're practicing with the different ways to form the stuff, then doing your drafting, your final drafting, et cetera, where you can name the moves you made, the concepts you used, and how you constructed and organized them for meaning and effect. This is a really, really powerful way of thinking about teaching to see if we're covering the ground for our students to understand genre, to do all the things they need to do to write a coherent text. Now, I use a technique called the inquiry square. I feature it in several of my books, where the foundation is the purpose and payoff, knowledge of purpose for reading or writing this kind of text. Then the cornerstone, which is inquiry. How do we get the stuff to comprehend or compose this kind of text? Then you build on that by shaping, having the shaping moves for maximum meaning and effect in ways that fit genre conventions. And as you do this work over on the right side, you're going to learn how to name the conceptual features and content and how to name the formal features and genre moves. And it's the how that leads to the what. And so it's very, very transferable stuff. Now, I just want you to brainstorm for a minute purpose and payoff for teaching narrative, whether it's reading or writing. We're going to be general first, and we're going to get specific later. So just think about this for a minute. If you're with somebody else, say, why should we teach stories? Why should we teach narrative? Why should we have kids write narratives or read them? Now, when I provide my answer to that question, I have things like stories help us see what we think is important. Narrative is a unique and powerful way of knowing. Arguments tell the story of our thinking. So even an argument's a story. Stories communicate values and explore possibilities. Stories provide imaginative rehearsals for our future living. Stories create community and communities of practice. Stories can create hope and resilience. Stories can help us learn how to navigate trouble. Stories can help us be known and to know others. We associate people with their stories. Stories can give ourselves and others warmth, light, and comfort. And I could go on, and I'm sure you had different answers that are equally as powerful and as useful as the ones I came up with. Now, how do we can get the stuff to write a story? So if you're helping kids to write a story, how do you help them get the stuff to get started? How do you help them with the procedural knowledge of substance? So just think about that for a minute. If you're with somebody else, you could tell them what you do when you're teaching kids to write a story. So what has to be in a story to make it a compelling and coherent story worth reading and writing? How do we help the students brainstorm and access the basic materials or stuff they can use when they're writing a particular kind of story? You know, if your kids ever have writer's block or trouble getting started, that means they need help with what's called rhetorical invention, with idea generation, with getting the stuff. And that's how all writing starts, with that procedural knowledge of substance based on knowledge of purpose and payoff. You know, things I do to help students brainstorm and access the basic materials or stuff is I help them generate characters. I help them generate settings through setting photographs and see, think, wonders. I help them think about a point of view and perspective through reframing activities, hot seeing activities. I help them come up with plots through problem scenarios and dramatic role plays of trouble. I help them think about theme through values explorations and controversial statements. And we'll go back to all of these things as we continue. But the point right now is, if you want kids to write a story, you got to help them do the things that are necessary to writing a story. And knowing how to write all these things helps you read stories and helps you understand content. Final question, how can we shape our stuff into a simple, conventional, powerful story? So say your kids have something they want to write about. How do you make sure that it fits the basic conventions of narrative? So turn to a neighbor if you've got one, or just think on your own. What are some things you do that help kids shape the stuff they have that they want to tell somebody about into a story? Now, when I'm getting started with stories with middle school kids, I'll do these things. I'll help them shape a short time span for the story to unify the narration. I mean, later on, I'll have them expand that, but to get started, I want a short time span, you know, when the action will take place. I help them think about era, psychological feel, explain why they want that to be the time span for the story. I get them started with two characters who have a conflict. You know, that can be expanded later, but I want them to start with that. A single physical setting, a single incident that will occur between two characters, which has to fit that setting and conflict. How do you introduce the conflict in the beginning of your plot? How do you outline how the initial conflict will get more complicated, come to a climax, be resolved, and what consequences will result? How does all that trajectory of the story express a theme? And that's how I get kids going. So there's a lot to do here, even for a very simple story. Now, if I was to put it into the inquiry square, it would look something like this. By the way, you're all going to get copies of this so you can refer to it later. Now, I want to take a look at reading and writing fables, because fables are a particular kind of narrative. Now, for many years, I taught seventh grade and I taught fables. And, you know, we read Aesopian fables and Fontanian fables, and I'd have kids write fables. And it was always annoying because the fables really weren't fables. They were crummy. And many of them featured me as a character. So there'd be a fable about Mr. Wilhelm's nose hair or something. If they did use animals, you know, the owls were driving Maseratis and things, you know, you would never happen in a regular fable. And it finally struck me, wow, I'm not actually teaching the kids about the genre of fables. So why would I expect them to know how to write one? So the first question is, why would anyone ever want to read and write a fable? In other words, what are the purposes of writing a fable? So after I got smart, we read three Aesopian fables And I said, oh, what seems to be the purpose of all three of these? And the kids very rightly said, to make fun of somebody who's got a shortcoming. Do you think seventh graders buy in to making fun of people who have blind spots or shortcomings? They absolutely do. And now they were tied into the purpose. Then I asked, how would we get the stuff to write a fable? So I asked them, let's brainstorm shortcomings that cause other people's problems. Like, my nose hair doesn't cause you a problem. It's not the worthy topic of a fable. So what kind of shortcomings that people are blind to actually cause other people's problems? How long do you think it took us to fill up the board? Like 3 minutes. And then I said, okay, let's choose the ones that really cause the most problems and that are soluble. Like, they're within the person's control. Then I said, those things we circled are the proper topics of a fable. Now, how could we generate some ideas about this problem and characters who have that problem and animals who might symbolize a person who has that problem? And, you know, how could we think about the problems, how they play out, how they could be solved, you know? And already we're into forming, you know, generating the stuff, but forming the subject and content into a fabulistic form. And then I asked them, okay, what does the trajectory of the story lead up to? You know, that has to be expressed in a moral, which is a very short phrase, a simple statement that mirrors the trajectory of the story. The kids wrote great fables. And my inquiry square looked something like this. And when you learn how to produce the substance of a fable, you are going to be able to name those things. The same thing is true for simple moves like dialogue. Let's say you want to teach the kids how to add dialogue to their fables or to their stories. Well, it's the same five kinds of knowledge. You're going to need a purpose and context, like writing a story or including conversation and kind of writing, in order to reveal character, further plot, et cetera. Then how can you make it happen? What kinds of things will help kids generate the substance of dialogue? How do you help them use the correct conventions? And then how do you help them name those things as you go through? Now, the five kinds of knowledge highlights for us, we have to develop conceptual knowledge through procedural. This is something cognitive scientists say all the time. The what is developed through the why and the how. Assistance is required over time in a context of actual use. If the kids are learning something new, you have to help them. We have to give them the deliberate practice they need. And practice, 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 practice leads to an understanding of how knowledge is structured in text types, genres, and through disciplinary knowledge structures and protocols. I want to take a brief moment to contrast mental models with algorithms. Mental models are flexible problem-solving repertoires that are based on principles so they can be developed and transformed in new situations. Algorithms are inflexible, lockstep, one-size-fits-all protocols for use. For example, the Freytag pyramid, the five-paragraph essays, which work pretty rarely, and they're not flexible. And they don't allow the kids freedom in constructing and understanding text for meaning and effect. The mental model is going to capture everything that's important about the Freytag pyramid or the five-paragraph essay in a much more flexible and multimodal form. Let's go a little deeper with genre here with a thought experiment. So imagine this scene. There are a few minutes before school starts. You're walking to your room. You see Colin, you go, hey, how are things going? What's the purpose in your greeting? What kind of response do you expect? What kind of response would you not expect? Just take a minute to think about that. Now, I've had this happen to me where I'm walking down the hall, I go, hey, how are things? And my colleague will grab me and go, oh my God, you won't believe what happened to me all night. And I'm thinking, genre violation. I was just saying, hello, I see you. I wasn't asking really for you to tell me all your problems. My daughter is a teacher and she likes to come to our house after the school day and she tells stories in the genre of outrageous things my students have done. So she'll tell something outrageous that a kid did or said that day. And I'll typically go, oh, let me think, help you think about how to deal with that. And she goes, Dad, genre violation, I want you to say, that's outrageous. That's the response for this genre. Now, let's think about coffee talk. A colleague comes into your room during break and asks if you have time to meet her for coffee right after work. What might be the purpose of this meeting? Now I'd expect something more serious. Now I'd think something that's going to take some time and some effort to deal with. So even these quick tip-offs tell us what's the appropriate response, how we are to understand that utterance and to follow up on it. Now, the takeaway is every genre is a mental map for reading and writing that kind of text. When kids know the mental map of the hero's journey, they're going to be able to write one. When they read one, they're going to know what to look for and how to have that help them create meaning. They'll be able to infer more easily, just like with the Dear John letter. When you know the mental map, then you know how to proceed as a reader, writer, composer. Now, here's our challenge in gut check. Genres must be specific enough to provide a mental map to readers and writers navigating or composing that genre. How schools typically teach genre is not very useful to readers and writers because it's too general. It doesn't go deep enough to provide a map. The critical issue is to cut genres finely enough to be useful, but not so thinly they're too complex. I put Feel the Groove there because Wayne Booth, very famous literary theorist, says genres are a fairly narrow groove. And if you're in the groove, it's going to take you where the genre needs you to go. Here's another takeaway. Genre is a social action. This comes from Carolyn Miller's research. A genre represents a kind of social action and provides a way to structure content to achieve one's ends through the rhetorical action of that genre. So genre itself is a social action meant to inspire some kind of internal understanding or external transformation and subsequent social actions in a reader. This is a really powerful insight that brings those things together that kids struggle with. Specific genres as social actions explore specific kinds of problems. So if you know the genre, you know the kind of problem it's going to address. Ask specific kinds of questions. You know the genre, you'll know the kind of questions it's going to ask and address them in particular kinds of ways through particular kinds of character types, settings, conflicts, plotlines. You know the genre, you're going to know the kind of characters, the kinds of settings, the kind of conflicts and plotlines that are going to ensue, and thus creates the framework for expressing specific kinds of thematic generalizations. Kids really struggle with themes and main ideas. If they understand the genre and the kind of problems and questions that genre asks, they're over halfway there to figuring out the themes. I put a public service announcement there, plastic bags kill. You know it's a public service announcement. You know that you're being asked to think about changing the way you are in the world and helping other people change too. And so you know that social action and you've got a way forward. Now let's look at historical fiction. ARC has a quarter long unit on historical fiction and social action. So what questions do text in the genre of historical fiction tend to ask? Just think about that for a moment, or if you're with somebody else, brainstorm with them. Now, here's some answers I came up with when I last taught a historical fiction unit. I think historical fiction asks what conditions and experiences make people who they are, make me who I am by extension, could have made me others different, can help me or others to become something different. What conditions have shaped human culture or my country? How could things be different, move forward, be transformed in order to develop and apply social imagination and to identify themes about how time, place, and historical circumstance shape culture, thinking, experience. Now, you may have come up with different answers that are equally valid, but that's going to help you and your students to meet your threshold knowledge goals and to identify themes and do all those things that the NAEPs and PISA show we struggle with. Now, narrative is not specific enough to be useful as a genre, but anytime we teach genre, there are certain things they have in common. For instance, these literary elements are always part of the form and structure of any narrative. There's going to be characters, perspective, setting, plot, action, so trouble, purposes, stakes, and there's going to be a theme expressed by the consequences and results of how the character resolves or doesn't resolve his or her problems. Now, each of these features has a mental model that can guide reading and composing, and these interact with all the other elements. Now, something I use to help my kids generate character, understand character, is I call it a G-saws. What are the goals of that character? Now, and think about that in historical fiction, and you can adopt this any kind of genre, there's going to be different things, or there's going to be constraints about the goals. The stakes for the character. In historical fiction, those are going to be historically determined. Actions taken by the character, actions and what's possible for the character will be historically determined in historical fiction. World the character inhabits, that's obviously going to be informed by the historical era of the historical fiction. And the struggles, the obstacles, challenges to be overcome, trouble. And if kids are having trouble coming up with trouble, then I might give them a list and give them some activities to come up with ideas for character trouble. So the mental model for understanding character, the things you have to notice to understand character would be names and nicknames, typical activities, their deepest hopes, desires, commitments, physical features, typical settings, clothing, company they keep, what others say about them, habits, problems and stakes, the change in what changes them. So these things are always generally true, to be specifically adapted depending on the genre you're reading. Same thing true with setting. Setting has its own mental models necessary to expert reading and composing. Now, literary theorists are fond of saying setting is rule setting. So when you have a setting in historical fiction, it's going to set particular rules on how the story will unfold, on the characters, et cetera. So a setting sets or determines rules, constraints, and possibilities, as well as consequences for conflict and characters. In essence, the levels and dimensions of setting work together to define and confine all the possibilities that might follow. I've used two engravings here from Hogarth. This is called Gin Alley, and the next one's Beer Street. The settings are very different, and it has to do with certain conditions. And these were basically public service announcements. Hogarth was trying to influence Parliament in their use of the gin laws. So setting is important to the degree that it affects behavior in the setting. For example, the degree to which it encourages or constrains different kinds of behaviors and effects. Now, in school, we often say setting is where a story takes place. That doesn't help kids as readers and writers. If they understand how setting sets rules to encourage or constrain behaviors and effects, now that's hugely useful, and that's going to help them when they read historical fiction, dystopia, fables, whatever.
And Jeff, this is so critical because so often people ask us about the setting and they want to simplify it and just move on. So I think what you're saying is just like in terms of let's make sure that we understand what we need to do to develop this mental model of expertise. If we read to them as writers and we pull out when we are reading, then the kids will notice. We have to name it so they can claim it.
Thank you so much, Amelia. You know, that's very, very important. One of the things I very much like about ARC is they deal with the complexity that is reading and writing. They deal with the complexity of content because that's actually what's necessary to developing expertise as readers and writers. But they give the support that's needed over these 9-week units to help you understand and help kids understand and practice those mental models. Now, setting, if we're going to do a mental model of it, it's going to operate on the micro, meso, and macro levels. I mean, think about your classroom. That's a microculture, but it's embedded in your school and community, which is a mesoculture, and it's embedded in the political and cultural situation of the United States or New Zealand, because we have people from there in 2022. Now, think about your reading Great Gatsby. There's the microculture of East Egg, but there's the mesoculture of the East Coast of the United States, and there's the macroculture of the power structure of wealth and status during the 1920s. Which in many ways mirrors the kind of power structure we have today. And it's the interaction of all these kind of things that offer invitations and constraints to the characters. Setting is also physical. There's a social and psychological element to setting. There's the temporal and there's duration. Now, you can see setting's pretty complex, but for kids to read and write with conscious competence, they have to get these elements of setting and how they work for meaning and effect. Here's a mental model for theme, which I find incredibly powerful. Even though the NAEPs and PISA show that fewer than 10% of our graduating seniors can tell you the theme or main idea of an extended text and justify that theme with evidence, I can teach third and fourth graders to do it with this topic comment strategy. It's just a question of instructional support. Now, if a theme is a comment about a topic, then kids need to identify the topic, the key details about that topic, how they're arranged in order to create meanings and effects. And that arrangement of key details about the topic expresses a comment about the topic, which would be a theme. So you can see how all those things that kids struggle with, according to the NAEPs, are actually, they work together and need to be taught together. Now, here's a mental model of expert reading, that whenever we're expertly reading anything, you're noticing a conversational topic, you're noticing the key details. Now, these things work together because you can't hone in on the topic until you know what all the key details have in common. When you've done that, you can hone in the topic even better. When you know some ideas for the topic, it's going to help you notice key details. You also have to notice the genre or superstructure, and you have to notice these embedded text structures and how these work to organize the key details to express meaning and effect and a theme. So all of these things work together. Now, a specific genre guides us to theme by highlighting what to notice and what to interpret. Because remember, specific genres deal with specific problems and questions. They deal with specific content. They're going to have specific form. Let's just take the example of dystopias, which is another ARC unit. Dystopias deal with social and environmental issues. They ask the question, what is the long-term effect of current ways of living? You know, if we extrapolate what's going on today with the environment, with politics, what will happen? So we have to notice, what are the qualities of the dystopic world that are extrapolations of problems in today's world? What are the qualities that give our heroes the agency to rebel? What causes the rebellion to succeed or fail? And this is what the themes are going to be about what kind of qualities help address these kinds of problems. And once kids know that, it's going to be much, much easier for them to engage with, comprehend, and understand the thematic generalizations from a dystopia. Now, several years ago, I was teaching Romeo and Juliet. I've actually taught Romeo and Juliet 39 different years. You can do the math on that. And I asked, what was the theme? And they all yelled out, love! And they go, nope, that's a topic. Love sucks! Nope, that's a bumper sticker. Finally, we got to the point where they said something like, romantic relationships can be destroyed by a combination of pressures from different sources like family, friends, group affiliation, religion, impulsivity, secrecy. Yes, we finally have a theme. And notice how it actually mirrors the substance of Romeo and Juliet. Theme is not a bumper sticker. It is a sophisticated, contextualized comment on a major topic of the text. When I teach the kids topic comment strategy, and we practice with pictures, and we practice with short excerpts and cartoons, and then we start applying it to these longer texts, they learn how to connect the dots. They learn how to see these complex implied relationships, and they learn how to identify topics, key details, and how they express a comment or a theme. Now, themes internally persuasive. I think this is really powerful. This is part of the unique power of literature, is that authoritative meanings are imposed. If a teacher tells you, do this, repeat this on the test, that's not internally persuasive. It's not transformational. But if internally persuasive meanings are affirmed and become convincing through lived through experience, the power of literature is that it doesn't tell you what it means. You have to figure it out and become internally persuaded of it. This is another thing I very much like about ARC that mirrors what I know from my own research and from cognitive science, is they engage the kids in these 9-week inquiries. And they don't tell the kids what to think about animal adaptations or whatever. They allow the kids to see the connections within a text and then across text and come to their own conclusions. That's internally persuasive. That will transform people's understanding over time. Now, here's a questioning strategy for understanding genre. Amelia?
And I think just like the importance of design, right? Because that happens through carefully designed research questions that keep the kids hooked, but gives them that purpose and payoff, but also the rubrics. So for example, if a teacher is learning with the students, they can use the writing rubric to actually read informational texts, right? So they start naming the moves that the author is making using the rubric until they begin to internalize and notice. So you have to make it concrete before they can go abstract.
Jacob Bronowski very famously said, he's a famous anthropologist, he famously said, There is nothing in your head that was not first in your hand. That all learning proceeds from the concrete to the abstract. So kids need very concrete experiences with these mental models. They need deliberate practice over time. And then they'll begin to abstract and transfer those things. I was introducing here a questioning strategy for understanding genre. It's called KEEP. You know, the kids can ask, what kind of text is this? What are the essential features? That will be all the stuff we just talked about. How did the author employ these features? Because genres are not monolithic. What was the author's purpose? And what meaning and effect did the author achieve through their use of this genre? Big takeaway, specific genres have got to make moves and want to make moves. So genres do have specific requirements for form, conventions, content, and many creative variations to achieve specific meanings. So I'm going to start my teaching with the specific requirements and then encourage the kids to start extending and experimenting with the want to do things. And again, learning about a genre helps with identifying topics, key details, inferencing themes, building conceptual mental models, content knowledge over time. So all of the things that the NAEPs foreground that our kids from upper elementary through high school have are things that this approach would help with. The most important things to remember about genre are that a specific genre addresses specific purposes and promotes specific social actions, involves circumscribed content, has a specific form, informs what we notice and how we interpret, how we will compose and create, and this promotes specific kinds of pleasure and expertise. So the five kinds of knowledge. Remember to teach all these things together and not separately, because all the elements co-produce the overall meaning. And remember, when we take things apart, then it's harder for the kids to put them together. Now, when we think of genre as social action in American Reading Company, the whole idea of genre resonates with ARC's message and mission. It's a powerful and often missed insight that can be very motivating and helpful to teachers, readers, and writers. So consider the purpose and implied social actions of the genres you study. Consider content and literary elements in addition to form. Monitor how these genre features might assist you in your role and assist learners to read and write, engage, know, think, and do. Now, Amelia was giving us an anticipatory set for how ARC does things. Again, I'm a thinking partner for ARC. I'm on their board, but the reason that I agreed to do that is because they actually do what the cognitive science says to do. They actually do what my research says to do. Notice that when you look at their pacing guides, there are three phases of instructional support. The first phase is developing and understanding expertise in action. Then it's analyzing expertise in action. Then it's creating and composing expertise in action. So the kids are getting these concrete experiences over and over and over again, deliberate practice over and over again, in ways that integrate the content and the strategy, that integrate identifying topics, key details, genre knowledge, theme. All these things go together in a way that's coherent. There's extensive reading around the content with the genre, practicing those must-make moves. There's extensive practice and sample resources to support developing mental models of a genre. And this is one for the American historical fiction. There's resources.
If I may say, I think this is really important, that design is everything when it comes to equity, right? Because every child is entitled to this grade level thinking and discussion, even when their skills are not quite at the grade level. They are still a part of a community and engaged in the read alouds and the guided conversations. When they apply, they might have to apply at a level that is more within what they can handle independently. But because you are working on a unit across time, the idea is by being a part of this community with guided practice, with coaching and scaffolding, over time you can handle more and more complex texts and tasks. So, but don't conflate skills with thinking. Every child is entitled to being a part of this intellectual learning community.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you so much for that, Amelia. And that's so true. This is absolutely a social justice issue. It's absolutely a civil rights issue that every, you know, equity is every kid getting what they need when they need it. You know, that's very, very important. And when you do a unit like this, kids can read different texts that are of interest to them. They get to use their cultural funds of knowledge and bring it to bear as a unique contributor. They get the deliberate practice they need. And everybody's going to meet these threshold knowledge goals. And it's made easier to do because the kids, over the course of 9 weeks, are really going to deeply understand the content, which makes understanding the genre, understanding the topics, key details, et cetera, easier. So there's so much to say about this and the power of the approach. There are many examples of the rubrics. Amelia referred to these. These express a mental model of how to read and write that particular kind of genre. And so the kids are just getting deliberate practice over and over again. Now, the test of teaching and learning is high road transfer. In other words, if I spend a lot of time teaching my kids something, I would expect them to flexibly use that in new situations and to flexibly expand and extend what they've learned in new situations. If they can't, I'd have trouble arguing that I taught them anything. Now, the research on transfer is actually pretty depressing. It's that it hardly ever happens. That in American schools anyway, we really don't teach in a way that promotes transfer. However, it can happen. And it happens if we do what's called 4D teaching and learning, which I've been implying throughout the session. If students have command of the knowledge that is to be transferred, so that's deep knowing of content and a procedure. If students have a theoretical understanding of the principles to be transferred, in other words, they can think with it, argue with it, talk about it, justify it. If a classroom culture cultivates a spirit of engagement and transfer, so engaging and doing, and you're always asking, how can you use this on your paper? How does this apply to the news? And if students get plenty of practice in applying meaning-making and problem-solving principles to new situations, so engaging and doing. If you do these four things, you get conscious competence, you get high road transfer. Central insight, what and how you compose can and should inform how you read and vice versa. Reading and composing are two sides of the same coin. What readers must do to make a text meaningful and lead to transform understanding and social action are the same things composers have to code into a text. Once students understand a genre, what can they then explore on their own in that genre? They should be able to do a lot of different things. If you want to know more about genre, more about narrative as a genre, more about genre as it relates to theme, these are three of my own books based on my own research that ARC makes great use of. I see we've got another 90 seconds. So is there anybody from ARC who would want to put in a concluding comment?
I'll do that, Jeff. As always, you leave our heads spinning with so much good information. We want to thank you for today. We want to thank everyone that participated. But just to reiterate, I hope you enjoyed our time together today. It's a lot to process. But boiling down, this cannot be about a little bit of this and a lot of that, right? Teachers should read, speak, and write frequently for many different purposes. So our students can read, speak, and write frequently and for many purposes. We should read as writers and unpack the moves we see, so then we can write as readers. Thank you so much, Jeff. Thank you, everyone.